So without further ado, let's have a spotlight on our next generation of leaders. Let's bring our young leaders on up to the stage. Come on up, emerging leaders.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. And I want to start off this panel by thanking all of our generous sponsors and just members of the Steamboat Institute who make it possible for us young people to make it here, and people that, like who Morgan mentioned, Olivia, who's here with us on scholarship. So like Jennifer mentioned, you guys have heard peppered throughout that we have the Steamboat Institute's Emerging Leaders Council, and we have five members, including myself, up here today. To just tell you a little bit more about the council, it's a group of young students and young professionals who are just liberty lovers, want to make a difference, and just need support to have impact. So the Steamboat Institute provides that by offering mentorship opportunities. We record a podcast that's run by the Emerging Leaders Council. We come to events like this and just a variety of opportunities that the Steamboat Institute provides. So I'm gonna let Matt, Christina, Marko, and Lindsey give a brief introduction of themselves, and then really we wanted to take this opportunity to offer all of you a chance to ask us young people questions, whatever comes to mind. Go ahead and scan those QR codes on your tables and start asking away.
Well, thank you guys for being here. My name is Matt Melchior. I'm a Hillsdale College grad, now living in Denver, working with the Denver Broncos, but there's been some things that have been concerning in the last 2 years with these lockdowns, and much longer than that, but I started to pay a little bit more attention to what was going on. And the Steamboat Institute has been so generous to us, and as you look around this room in the conference, you've probably seen how many young people there are involved. And I know that you guys are concerned about the future, and they've done a great job at highlighting us and giving us opportunities. And in that last panel, they mentioned mentorship as something that you should do with your kids and, you know, employees. But a lot of you have already done that through this conference just by networking with us and having conversations. So I want to encourage you we are emerging leaders. Some of us are already doing great things, but we're not established leaders yet. So think of ways that you can help us. And I ask you to continue to be open to having conversations and seek out the young people in this room and be ready to help. And so we got some great people up here doing some great things. So listen, be receptive, and think how you can help us, because we gotta be in this together.
Thank you, Matt. That's a tough act to follow as usual. My name is Christina Eastman. I'm super thrilled to be sharing this stage with these incredible people. I have to make an apology though. I'm a California transplant, but I love the beautiful state of Colorado, and I live in Centennial, and I hope I'm here for the long haul. I also hope you'll forgive me because of my involvement with the Steamboat Institute and in the movement. So I come from a slightly unorthodox background. I have a degree in violin performance, and I have another degree in mechanical engineering. So it was the natural progression for me to end up in the Liberty Movement, I would say.
Of course.
But no, in all seriousness, I landed my dream job a couple years ago. I work with American Philanthropic. And for those of you who don't know, it's a national strategic consulting firm working to strengthen civil society. And we work with nonprofits at the national, state, and local level in the liberty, free market, conservative movement space, Christian Catholic organizations fighting these important culture battles. And you know, at the national and state level, we work with groups like Turning Point USA and Mountain States Legal Foundation. And at the local level, we work with you know, the little platoons working to strengthen civil society, like crisis pregnancy centers and churches. I also wanted to mention I am a violinist in the Boulder Symphony. It's my side hustle, as I call it. And I was thrilled to be playing string quartets for you all last night. It was a pleasure to be playing in the mountains. So thank you for having me. And on the note of music, I just want to end with a quote from Plato's Republic, a loosely translated quote from Plato's Republic. The introduction of novel fashions in music is a thing to beware of as endangering the whole fabric of society. And I think a gap I see in the conservative movement today is that we aren't thinking of music as a regime-level question, a regime-level potentially horrible thing for our society. And, you know, for the classical music fans out there, I think about the progression from Baroque music to classical music to the Romantic era to 21st century music. And, you know, we've kind of, this progression has led us into degenerate rap music and in some cases degenerate orchestral music. And I parallel that progression to the decay of Western civilization in a way. And I think, you know, I'm sure you can guess that there aren't a lot of conservative musicians out there, so I feel a personal duty and responsibility to think about these regime-level questions of music and, you know, make that my fight. So come talk music to me afterwards, come talk nonprofits to me afterwards, and I look forward to your questions.
Hello, my name is Marko Sukovic. I am, for lack of a better term, I'm a community organizer from Chicago, so I'm not sure what a bunch of conservatives thought about bringing me here, but it's an honor to be here. Thank you to the Steamboat Institute, the donors, the sponsors that put this together. For me, the Steamboat Institute is much more than a think tank. In many ways, it's a battle tank, and it's taking the ideas that we're talking about here on stage out to college campuses. It's taking this idea that we should have discourse in our communities, and I'm not just talking about in college campuses, but as we've seen in our school boards all across the country, and that is something worth fighting for and being a part of, and so I'm just so inspired to be a part of it. I mentioned that I'm technically from the Chicago suburb, so you don't have to knock me too much on that, but I'm a part of an initiative that's actually in part inspired by, some of you may be familiar with a book called The Blueprint, which was a book that documented how Colorado moved from a more reliably red state to a bluer state. And I think some of the speakers touched on that. Basically what we do, I'm not in the nonprofit space. I started a business. I've got three co-founders. And we're a startup, a Republican technology and data firm out of Chicago. And our mission is to essentially try to replicate what was done in Colorado and with the vision of turning Illinois, God willing, into a red state by 2030 or sooner. And we could talk about that afterwards, but basically what I do on a day-to-day basis is I'm sitting and, I'm sitting in kitchen tables in the rooms of people that are thinking about running for office at the local level, people looking to run primarily for the state legislative office, so state Senate, state House of Representatives. In the state of Illinois, unfortunately, we have Democratic supermajorities in both of our chambers, so I think you guys have a little bit of a better setup here, and at least you're not in the super minority. But what we find, and what basically Suris attempts to do, there are a lot of barriers that prevent good, quality people from running for office. And I don't know what it's like in Denver, but in Springfield, Illinois, we're not sending our best and our brightest. And there's a reason for that. It's because there are these barriers to entry. There's no party infrastructure that people running for office for the first time that have a lot to offer to the conversation. There's no party infrastructure that they're walking into, you know, with just volunteers kind of just pouring out of the woodwork to help them out, right? There's no cultivation of donors happening in the state. And there, Illinois, you know, it's got a lot of entrepreneurs. It's got people that have built incredible businesses. There's over 30 Fortune 500 companies in the state of Illinois. And so it has that spirit. There, you know, it has all these components, very similar actually to the state of Colorado with all the natural resources that you guys hear. We have Lake Michigan. So much to go for us, and yet we're lagging the nation, right? And so what we basically do is we go out, put people that are looking to run for office, we put them on a platform to help them get situated, get managed and organized on how to run a campaign and help them, you know, turn the state around. That's kind of our goal. So I'm happy to talk about that in greater detail. Maybe there's some things and thoughts that we might be able to share about Colorado, and I think that there's a lot of potential here if you look around this room. But yeah, that's basically my backstory. Again, honored to be part of this panel here and to be part of this experience. Thank you. Okay.
Wasn't that last panel fantastic? My name is Lindsey Martin, and I am from Claymore, Oklahoma. So I am proud to say that we are a red state. And in this past cycle, thankfully, we gained back our congressional 5th district that turned blue for one cycle. But thankfully, everyone saw what was happening and was like, uh-oh, what mistake did we make? So so currently I am director of the TSET Healthy Living Program of Rogers County. It is a state-based grant, so we focus on healthier choices and reducing tobacco. I currently serve on my local Salvation Army's advisory board, and I'm former chair of my county's Republican Party, and I held that seat when I was 26. And so I just wanted to talk about the Steamboat Institute's new Liberty Chats. It is a podcast series that we just launched this past year, and it has given our council an amazing opportunity to get to talk to people from all different sectors, people who research policy, serve in a political position, reality TV people. I got to talk to Garrett Powell, who you guys just saw. So that platform that we've had has been a tremendous opportunity, especially since we launched it in the midst of COVID. That is something that we can do digital. I can be in my state of Oklahoma talking to someone in California, DC. It's such a great thing, and that is something that during my time of serving on the council, this is my third Freedom Conference, that has been something that, because you guys have supported us through what we get to do, you guys are leveraging the conservative voice and helping us to reach a broader group. Also, during my time here, I have been able to chat with several people, and we know that you guys are concerned about what does this next generation look like. I am 30, so I am a millennial, so I am not a Gen Zer, but I kind of consider myself of like straddling both sides because I want to stay current on what's happening, whether it's Snapchat, whatever the latest thing is, that we have to stay current with what's happening and what kids are using. And so just know that we feel that burden, and your support helps us to reach the group. So thank you. So I look forward to any possible questions. Thank you.
We did get a few audience questions. Feel free to continue to send them in. We have about 10 minutes for questions. I want to direct this question to Matt and Lindsey because, as they just mentioned, they don't work necessarily in a political office or in a political job. What led you to your decision to get involved in the political world?
Well, I'll tell you a story. So right when the COVID lockdowns happened, I was a little frustrated and I said, you know, we're not doing this. I want a beer after 10 p.m. at the bar. And I want to have my partners be able to run their businesses. I got to run for mayor. We're getting Hancock out of there. And so I call my sister, Jillian K. Melcher, who's been featured a couple times. She goes, well, that's not how it works. you're going to have to do a little bit more. And so, I got in touch with Rick and Jennifer. And I'm relatively new to Colorado and Denver, but I was just overwhelmed with the support and how quickly, I mean, it was 2 hours later, both of them were on the call. I think Rick was in the basement, Jennifer was on the top. They didn't even know that they were communicating with me at the same time, and I had an hour conversation. But there are so many resources out there, and so I've just been encouraged by the conversations I've had and how accessible people have been. So I don't know what that means long term, but it's encouraging to see what's going on, and I'd like to continue to see us open up and be leaders, because a lot of the free market principles probably could have solved COVID without any lockdowns.
So I guess I would have to say that it started when I paged for my state house rep when I was a junior in high school. I saw how the political process was, you know, done as like far as writing a bill, going through, you know, all of those different phases, and I was fascinated by that. So it was that that really led me to get my bachelor's in political science. And in college, I did all of the clubs, the student government, all of these various things. And it's so funny because when I was going through all of those phases, when people learned what I was studying, they were like, why would you want to go into politics? Or, oh, and I was like, why is it such this negative feeling when I say it? Like, I'm excited because I'm wanting to make change and to be the voice for a lot of different people. And so that's kind of been something that's always stuck when I've gone through all of these various stages. After college, I got to intern at the Heritage Foundation, and I cannot be more thankful for what that did, because it took me out of my state, gave me new experiences, I met new people, and really leveraged my understanding of what our country was founded, you know, on, because they actually take their students through a first principles class. And so I did that, and then I was a state campaign finance director and scheduler, and I was 23. So that taught me a lot. And then I was asked to run for my county's party. And I literally asked them, I was like, I am 26. No one else in the entire county wants to run. So you're asking me? So it was that kind of thought of like, I am too young. Why are you asking me this? But I did it, and it was a great experience. It was honestly crazy because it was right before, or it was during the midst of like Trump running his like first time. And so I did not know that they give your cell phone number out to the county election board. So the whole public has your cell phone number. So I learned quickly how to like navigate things at a young like age when I'm like, I've had no experience doing this, but okay. So I don't want to take up too much time. So that's kind of the journey.
Yeah, thank you, Lindsey. One of the questions that came in is, what are some suggestions to outreach politically to high schoolers and at that level? So maybe Christina and Marko, would you want to take a stab at that?
Sure. So just some background. Illinois is actually where Turning Point USA was started. So believe that or not, I grew up 15 minutes away from Charlie Kirk, and it was actually involved in some of the formative years of the organization. So that was like 2013 to 2015. That was like when we were high school kids, running with like chickens with their heads cut off, basically going around the county parties and that kind of stuff, trying to have conversations and like, hey, can we take 5 minutes to talk about what we're trying to do? You know, and it's incredible to see how far it's grown. My recommendation to people that are in high school is you'll encounter this thing called school administrations, and they will try to block you from organizing events, organizing programming of all kinds. And my word of advice is it's always better to ask for forgiveness than it is to ask for permission. And so I strongly recommend that you pass that along to you know, if they don't want to have you on the school campus, meet at a Starbucks. Figure it out. You know, we can't afford for you guys not to organize. So that's just my comment there.
Christina, I'm actually going to flip to another question for you to get through a couple more. This one just came in. What are your future goals for the state and the nation in terms of public policy? So that's a lot to unpack as a young person, but I'll sort of change that to just, where do you see our impact in politics for the future?
If I could quickly answer the previous question. So two quick things. One, Lindsey brought up a really great point of, as much as it's not fun, we do need to be on Snapchat, we do need to be on Instagram, our generation especially, we need to know what these high schoolers are engaging with. And then I guess another thing that I would say is actually to the parents of a high schooler. My parents get asked all the time, you know, how did your kids turn out okay? I guess I turned out okay. and their advice is always, my mom sat at every PTA meeting. She sat in the classroom whenever she could to keep an eye on the teachers. She read every single book from kindergarten to, gosh, probably my senior year of college. She read every single book that I read. And so it's really important for the high schoolers to be to have this involvement with the parents. And then I think on the last panel they were talking about you know, having these discussions at the dinner table, and I think that's really the most important thing we can do, like at the family level.
What is your hope for the future of the country?
My hope for the future of the country, gosh. Well, the first thing that comes to mind is election fraud. I think we really need to get a handle on that.
Yeah, well, that's good.
I have a rapid fire question for Matt. Are you running for mayor?
Not in Denver, no.
Well, I'll go ahead and wrap it up here so that we can stay on time, and I know we're between all of you and lunch. But like Matt, and I think we've all mentioned it, your support really does mean the world in any capacity that you're able to support, whether it's through your finances, through your mentorship, through your supporting of other leaders. And if you have any young people in your life who you think would enjoy coming to this conference, it'll be the same time next year. So encourage them to apply for our scholarship program. We have 25 incredible young people here with us this weekend that I hope you have all had the opportunity to get to know and meet. And your support is really what allows us to emerge as leaders for this country. And we know that it's a major concern of everyone here of where is the country going in the next 10, 20, 30, 50 years, and what will it be like for your grandkids? And you can all have a really great impact on that by supporting us, giving us your wisdom and knowledge. And that's really the greatest thing that you can do for all of us. So thank you so much for your support and for joining us.
And I'm gonna, one more comment if I can. There was one, I can see you guys are getting antsy for lunch and to take a break, and we've had so much conversation. But we talked about flexing, and Jennifer doesn't know I'm gonna do this, but I am a revenue generator, that's what I do. And I'm gonna ask you to continue to donate financially to Steamboat Institute so that we can get more young people involved and more training, and there's some great things going on. So thank you for what you've already done, but please write more checks because they're doing great work.